Well, thank you very much, Leonard, for the introduction, and welcome everybody. I'm actually speaking to you from Killearn, north of Glasgow. So I'm in Scotland at the moment, not in Amsterdam, not where I work. And it's a delight to be here, and I'm incredibly grateful to the Royal Philosophical Society of Glasgow for the invitation to speak and to present the Minerva lecture. Minerva, of course, was associated with wisdom and the patron of institutions of learning and the arts, crafts, music, magic, and sciences. So in fact, she represents this almost, you would say, an interdisciplinary approach, which is, and I left the war out for now, because she, of course, is also the goddess of war. But let's stay with the association with wisdom. And she represents almost an interdisciplinary approach that is exactly what technical art history is. So I focus my research on how art was made and all the facets that connect to that, everything around that, the cultural and artistic environments artists and artisans worked in, and so on. And to be able to do that, and to really try and get into the skills of these artists, it's really important to work in an interdisciplinary manner. And I do work a lot with scientists, because we now have many, many scientific methods available that will help us to analyze artworks and objects to understand how they were made. Coming from the Rijksmuseum, I can't, of course, start this talk without telling you a little bit about Operation Nightwatch, which is the biggest conservation project so far that the Rijksmuseum has engaged with. Here you see the glass house, as we call it, built around the Nightwatch. And there's a stage in front of the Nightwatch where all kinds of equipment is being used by all kinds of scientists. A whole big team of more than 30 people are working in this project. Many of them young postdocs and PhDs, all with different expertises, working with the curators, art historians, and technical art historians to really understand what Rembrandt was using, the kind of materials, the kind of techniques, why certain materials age and degrade, to really map that all. And so this whole last year, despite the lockdown, fortunately, quite a lot of things could continue. I was just told that they collected 600 terabytes of data from all the scanning and all the methods that imaging methods that have been used, which is massive. If you know that the data on all the whole collection of the Rijksmuseum, which is a million objects, is around 150 terabytes. So that is the modern way of examining artworks, lots of data, but then all these data need to be interpreted. And I'll just show you an image of the Nightwatch and a detail of the beautiful embroidery that you can see there in the center. And we now can zoom in and get so close to the paint surface that we really can see every brushstroke and every pigment particle almost present in the paint layers of Rembrandt. Here's another detail. And these photographs are taken in super high resolution, but they will tell you so much that it is really important for the conservation treatment as well, to make decisions on how to clean the painting. Do we clean the painting? What kind of treatment are we going to do, decisions that need to be made, but also to get really close to understanding what Rembrandt was doing here. Well, that brings us to the 16th and 17th century period of painting, which will be my major focus during this talk. And I want to start with a quote, and I won't quote a lot, but I will start with this quote from Philip Angel. He was a painter in Leiden, and he gave a speech to all the Leiden painters who were specialized in very detailed painting. He called it In Praise of Painting, and it was done in 1642. He states that we say that the art of painting is far more general because it is capable of imitating nature much more copiously. For in addition to depicting every kind of creature like birds, fishes, worms, flies, spiders, and caterpillars, it can render every kind of metal and can distinguish between them, such as gold, silver, bronze, copper, pewter, lead, all the rest. It can be used to depict a rainbow, rain, thunder, lightning, clouds, vapor, light, reflections, and more of such things, like the rising of the sun, early morning, the decline of the sun, evening, the moon illuminating the night with her attendant companions, the stars, reflections in the water, human hair, horses foaming at the mouth, and so forth, none of which the sculptors can imitate. This was, of course, all about the so-called paragone, this comparison between what sculptors could do and painters could do. So there's a little bit of that politics in here as well. But he was talking about painting as an art of illusion, where you could create in paint any material and any part of nature. And on the right, you see a very small painting by Gerard Douw, who was one of the fine painters in Leiden. And this is all about that deception. You see the niche, which is made of stone. You see the book sticking out almost in our space. You see the curtain, which is the weave has been identified as a certain type of silk because it is so detailed. And of course, the whole thing is a trompe-l'oeil with this curtain that is seemingly outside the painting, but it is actually painted part of the painting. So how did these painters build up that kind of skill? How did they get to really be so technically able to deceive, if you like, and to create these illusions? That was a long road, and I'm showing you a model here that comes from the book of Roger Kneebohm, which is called Experts, Understanding the Path to Mastery, and I can really recommend that because it's a very wonderful description of that. But the model that he uses is a well-known medieval guild model, because in the guilds you would be trained, and there were regulations on how the training would be. But you would start with doing time, learning in the studio. You would use your senses, because the whole making of art in that period was very sensory. You needed to understand how something would feel and how something would smell when you were preparing something. Your sense and your eyes, everything was part of that. And it was, you know, you're part of a space with other people. So in a workshop, you would collaborate with your master and other assistants and apprentices, the whole sort of choreography between all these people in the studio. Then you would become a journeyman because you are now experienced. And then you start to develop your own voice. It's no longer just about you, because you can start teaching others as well. When you become a master, then it's all about passing on that knowledge and that experience and that skill. So how, as a technical art historian, do I learn about all these things? But, well, first of all, of course, by examining artworks, but also very importantly, by looking at all kinds of texts. And those texts are treatises and manuals, recipe books from the medieval times onwards up till even now. And those are repositories of artisanal and artistic knowledge, as I call them, because there you find jotted down, written down, all these kind of instructions and recipes. Mind you, many, many times they are not that clear, and there's a lot of knowledge in there that is not written down. Like, we would not write down every step in making a cake or baking a bread because we know it so well. You leave those kind of things out, a sort of tacit knowledge, as we call it. But still, there's a huge amount of information. I just show you some examples of these wonderful texts on the left, a German text all about working in copper, on making engravings on the right, an Italian book of secrets with lots of different recipes for color making, but also more modern ones like paint and color mixes. And you see the little samples of color, or a book on dyeing textiles with little pieces of cloth in the different colors in there. And there's many, many more. So to explain to you how this all works, I would like to tell you a couple of case, present to you a couple of case studies. And the first one is a case study of mastering color. And I will start again with one of these texts. And it's a really interesting, very unique text by a certain A. van der Bogert, a Dutch man who wrote this, the clear lighted mirror of painting. And on the left, you see the title page with a beautiful butterfly. It's dated 1692, and he wrote it in Delft, the city of Johannes Vermeer. On the right, you see the title page, De klaarlichtende spiegel der verfkunst, with the painter sitting here drawing, painting in a beautiful frame, and his assistants grinding paint. This is 800 pages, and it is in Aix-en-Provence in the Mejean Library. It's a very unique document because it's very small, about this high, and every page explains a color or mixtures of color. For example, here you see on the left is always the text, and on the right you have the samples of color. And this is another couple of pages from it. And you end the book with a register, so a register, which has all these different colors. And it says on which page you can find instructions on how to make that mixture. Well, this is 800 pages long, and it represents the main pigments. And it is totally unique to, because it's like a Pantone color chart, but then from the late 17th century. And we've never found another book like this. So why would somebody make a book like this? Well, very recently we found something really interesting, and that is another three volumes of books which have images, watercolors of all kinds of animals and insects. And this is the title says various types of lizards and dragons, seahorses, crocodiles, snakes, etc., etc., all kinds of animals, including very big ones and very small ones like winged animals, which is insects. And it's made by Adriaan van den Bogert. And the handwriting we found very similar to the color chart book, if I can refer to it like that. And in the title here of this volume, and you see one page of butterflies from the volume, it says that all this is painted after its own natural colors observed and drawn after life. So after nature, the way it looks in nature. In the color chart book, in the introduction, the same Bogart, we think, writes, come and read this book, which will engage you as both through the eye and through text. You will be taught what to do to give everything after life, so after nature, its color and character properly and accurately. And that is why this book is full of colors, and how these are prepared, you will see presented next to them. So that is really interesting, because we think that there is a clear connection here between wanting to depict all these animals, butterflies and insects really accurately after nature, and needing to have the right colors. And if you would have a color chart like that, all you needed to do is find the correct color if you have a preserved butterfly there, And then the book will tell you which colors to mix, which pigments to mix. So that was really fascinating. And then placing that into a bigger context, from exactly the same year, we have another text, which is called The Big World Painted Small, or Colorful Tableau of the World's Painting, concisely. And this is a treatise by a painter called Wilhelmus Beurs, written and printed in Amsterdam, 1692, the same year as the color chart book. And again, you see here the title page and the image with several young women painting, and it's dedicated to his pupils, female pupils. Beurs talks a lot about the mixing of different colors, and says that this with regard to the mixing of colors, then this art appears infinite, an indefinable sea in which a person can lose his way. For this reason, a painter can best apply himself to mastering that which is most in keeping with his individual character, in order to experience the greatest pleasure in aspiring to a high degree of perfection. So clearly, mixing colors, understanding all these things, is a really important skill of a painter. And this all connects really well, because Beurs also talks about the way you then use these colors. And I'm showing you here two paintings by a painter called Otto Marsijs van Schrik, an Amsterdam painter, and Melchior de Hondenkoeter, a contemporary of van Schrik. And these pieces are so-called sotto-bosco scenes, which means forest floor. They're all in the forest, in, you know, when you go into a forest and suddenly there's so many trees and shrubs and it's dark and damp, and you smell the mosses and the lichen, and there you can imagine all these moths and butterflies and mushrooms and snakes and lizards all in there. It's all symbolic for the transience of life, life and death, that kind of iconography behind these paintings. Well, Willem Beurs, the treatise writer that I just showed you, dedicates a whole chapter to this. He starts with creeping things and other creatures of that nature. He mentions snails, worms, snakes, adders, lizards, scorpions, toads, frogs, which populate these so-called sotto-bosco scenes. You can sort of totally see these dusky woodland settings composed of all these mosses and toadstools and dead tree trunks. And they are found in these works, and there are several other painters who also, Dutch painters, who also start painting these scenes. Beurs gives detailed instructions on how to paint one of these creeping things, namely the water snake, but refrains from describing any others, because a painter who has the life situation before him, says Beurs, will be able to paint it well enough. So you needed to have the real thing, the snake, whether it is a stuffed one or a real one, or one, you know, in a jar, but clearly that is what he aims at. To create this life situation, some artists indeed collected a variety of these species themselves. So the painter and writer Arnold Houbraken explains in his Great Theater of Dutch Painters how Marsijs van Schrik, the painter on the left, raised snakes for his own use, and how the snakes, after some time, were so used to him, says Houbraken, that he, pushes them with his mahlstick in the position he needed, and they would stay still until he finished painting them. Sounds a bit unlikely, to be honest, but that is what Houbraken writes. Another painter and theorist, Samuel van Hoogstraten, describes how he visited Marsijs van Schrik in Rome, because he traveled to Rome like most painters did at the time. He visited him in 1652 and marveled at the many monsters the painter owned, and I quote, whose nature he understood so well that he could depict them very lively indeed, end of quote. He was nicknamed in Rome by the local Dutch and Flemish artist community the snuffelaar, the sniffer or forager, for his collecting of all kinds of reptiles, insects, and strange plants and herbs. an activity he continued when he returned to Amsterdam in the 1660s. So von Schrieck, as well as Rachel Ruys, and I'll show you a work by her later on, who was the daughter of the famous anatomist Frederik Ruys, sometimes applied real butterflies in their paintings. Retouched them just a tiny bit with oil paint, thus forging a close connection between nature and art, and striving, you could say, for the ultimate realism. We know that many of these paintings, we hoped to find a lot of these butterfly wings in the paintings, but that is the research that is still ongoing. This getting really close to nature and this ultimate realism is not new in that sense. So here I show you a beautiful watercolor by Joris Hoefnagel from almost a century earlier. Of these insects here, and the wings that you see in this image are real wings. So this whole way of working was not new in itself. And we know that Beuys in his treatise describes several scholars that provide examples to painters of all these animals and insects. And one of them, for example, was Johannes Goedaert. And here you see the title page of the book from Goedaert. So the theater of caterpillars, worms, maggots, and small flying animals coming from them, collected through my own experience. So again, also from the science side, This real direct experience is very important. He illustrates the three volumes with woodcuts, which were not taken from other books, but described and drawn based on the author's observations. And he even now and then describes the colors that you would need to color them in. So very nice sort of crossover between the science and the arts here. And he describes how he used a magnifying glass to be very accurate. Going back to von Schrieck and the real butterfly wings, this is a piece of research from colleagues in France who looked at this particular painting from von Schrieck and the butterfly that you see. And that is a detail we are going to look at. They are researchers from CRMF2 in Paris, and the painting is in Grenoble. They believe von Schrieck actually prepared the wings with a method that encapsulates them in a varnish, a method known as lepidochromy, which is described for the first time in 1780 in France, so quite a lot later. So that is still a big question. But looking at what they found, you see here at the top the preserved wings from a butterfly, front and back, and the real wing here without the varnish. And here the wing is covered with a varnish. You immediately see an issue here because there's a change of color, the blue, iridescent blue in these wings. Then with the varnish covered has a similar refractive index and you no longer see it. So that is also interesting because this is that butterfly that we see in the painting. This detail you see here. And these are the scales of the wings of the butterfly, and they're stuck into now seemingly a white paint that was all underneath the whole butterfly. And this blue actually is paint. So von Schrieck retouched where the blue was no longer visible with a little bit of lapis lazuli blue, ultramarine blue. Very, very interesting. This, of course, is still part of research. And in 2022, the Rijksmuseum organizes a big exhibition with, amongst others, paintings by von Schrieck, De Hondenkoeter and Rachel Ruys, where we want to do an extensive research on these methods. But what you can understand is that von Schrieck must have looked at how butterflies were preserved at the time, the different methods, the how to do that. And that is something the French researchers called lepidochromy, but is that what he did? And there's a lot of work there to be done. But he clearly adopted yet another skill next to being a perfectly capable painter. He could, of course, paint these butterflies in paint, but he made himself obtain another skill to be able to actually really introduce these wings in the painting. Unfortunately, many of these wings, the pigments fade, and many of those butterflies now look quite pale. They did do other things as well. And I show you here two paintings by Van Schrik and Hondekoeter. And if you zoom in on the bottom part, then you see all the mosses and lichen there that you would typically find on a forest floor. And there too, the patterns are very unusual, not something you can do with a brush. And it is most likely that they used real lichen and real mosses to stamp a kind of paint on the surface. And when you look at a cross section from that area, and a cross section is a tiny, tiny sample that we can take very, very rarely, but we sometimes take a cross section the size of a grain of salt, and we embed it in a piece of a resin, and then polish it in a right angle so we can actually see the sandwich of the layers of ground preparation, paint layers, and varnish layers. And that is what you see in this image here. So one is the ground layer. Two is this green layer underneath that you see through. And then there's this white, and then a yellow, and another greenish layer. So the white is actually the stamp of the lichen and the mosses. And it's probably done with a different kind of paints to be able to do that. We've been experimenting with that, and they needed to manipulate the binding media to do that. Absolutely fascinating. And it connects very well with the interest in nature printing at the time, already introduced by Leonardo da Vinci. Here you see a leaf of salvia with his text around it. Da Vinci is not so happy with the result, so he doesn't pursue it, but others did. And here you see an early 18th century page from a book about how to actually do it. And it shows an absolutely beautiful nature print. So this realism introducing these nature prints is really fascinating. And this is a painting by Rachel Ruys. I mentioned her already, a fantastic painter who you can admire in the Calvin Grove Art Gallery as one of my favorite paintings. It's not the best image. It's a beautiful painting with the mosses. The lizard, definitely look at the lizard. It's absolutely stunning how that is painted. Lots of questions about that. Butterflies there too. And what is so really nice, that just because I like it so much, is this is two pages from a Thesaurus Animalium Primus from her father, who worked with artists who made prints where you see animals and other kinds of species in a jar. And then he represented that in this volume with snakes surrounded with insects and with this beautiful sort of still life arrangements on top, where everything seems to come together. So the impact of the father on the daughter and the other way around is definitely present here. So this whole environment of these painters, so closely connected with natural scientists, comes out in these paintings. And so understanding what artists do and developments in their skill, we always need to look into this broader environment. Another story, an unusual story of skill building and material intelligence, if we can call it that way, is the following. So we're talking about material intelligence. What does that mean? It means that an artist or an artisan knows the material so well that he knows exactly what he or she can and cannot do with that material, what the material allows or not. Martin Heidegger describes this very, very succinctly in in this quote here, if he, the apprentice, is to become a true cabinet maker, he makes himself answer and responsible of all to the different kinds of wood and to the shapes slumbering within the wood, to wood as it enters into man's dwelling with all the hidden riches of its nature. In fact, this relatedness to wood is what maintains the whole craft. This relation to the material is really, really important for skill building and understanding what you can do. A beautiful example of that is life casting. Life casting is done in many various ways in the 16th century. So we're going a little bit back in time, but we stay with this art nature relation, after life, after nature. So here you see a couple of examples of details of the beautiful ceramics of Bernard Palissy, a French ceramist, where all the animals like this beautiful lizards were cast after life. That was not such an easy thing. When they were digging in Paris not so long ago to build in the center of Paris, they found the former workshop of Palissy with lots of these kind of examples of molds for casting life animals and that he used. So an enormous richness there of all these kind of different materials came up, which helped to reconstruct what Palissy did. Palissy himself also wrote about that in his treatise, in his discourse. And he talks about the trial and error, if you like, in skill building. I'm not going to read the whole quote, but he talks about the experience is the mistress of the art. You have to do it again and again and again. And he says, some of my enamels turned out fine and well melted. Others were poorly melted. Others were burned, showing how difficult this all was. And he finishes with, I was like a desperate man. I had to do double work, pound, crush, and fire up the kiln. I was forced to burn up all the props that held up the plants in my garden. And then I was forced to burn the tables and the floor of my house. Well, this is a quite an extreme form of that struggle of keep, but it shows it, that he kept trying, kept experimenting until he got it absolutely right and was able to make those incredible, beautiful plates. But once he gets it right, he says that he wants to keep it a secret. So with my art of the earth and many other arts, that is not so. For many charming inventions are contaminating and despised because they are too common. Only if I thought you would keep tight the secret of my art as jealously as it deserves, would I not hesitate to teach it to you. This in his Discours Admirable 1580. Very fascinating man. And similar life casting was done also in metal. Here you see an example on the left, which is in the Rijksmuseum, of snakes and lizards. And on the right, a beautiful box, a writing box from Wenzel Jamnitzer, where all the animals and plants on the outside are live cast. Well, to tell you a little bit more about that, I show you this amazing table ornament. It's a huge piece about a meter high in the Rijksmuseum, and it has been restored not that long ago, which allowed us to really get closer into contact with this wonderful object. And as you can see at the top here and at the bottom, there is lots of plants, materials, and all kinds of little animals present. How did they do that? Well, these plants and little lizards, etc., are live cast too. And in a recent project called Making and Knowing, Columbia University, a wonderful manuscript in the Bibliothèque Nationale de France was discovered. It has been fully transcribed and translated, and you can see everything on the Making and Knowing website. It's absolutely fantastic, but it also contains recipes for live casting. And here you see some details of the plants from the Jamnitzer piece that I showed you, and it's just incredible how beautiful and how detailed that is. And there's also some color here and there added It's silver and gilded here, and also it's absolutely stunning, the detail and how natural it actually looks. Well, to live cast something like that, including also the little animals, and I'll show you an example soon, you need to follow all these recipes that are in that French manuscript. And I'm only going to read a little bit of it, but it is so wonderful and it totally tells you the story. So having gotten in some fat earth called clay, that should be gray because that is the best one, make a lasagna or a pancake shape of this clay, equally flattened with a rolling pin, which pastry makers use. There are often connections with cooking in many of these recipes, by the way. And on this pancake, affix your animal, making it as lifelike as possible and the way in which it is naturally shaped. And firstly, with a good needle, pierce it from underneath in the middle of the throat up to the top bone of the head. Then take the needle out and in the hole, put a point of an iron wire of such a length that it suffices to maintain the head of the animal as high as it must be. And if the skin gets in when you put in the wire, take it out with the edge of your small pincer and arrange the skin as it was before. Piece the other end and so on it goes. Arrange afterwards the rest of the body and the legs and the curling as you think will look best. So with little pins, etc., you arranged the animal. There's another recipe where it goes in much more detail how to kill the animal and how to pin it live, which I will save you. But on the right, you see a mold with a big beetle, which was already dead. So no animals were damaged for all these recipes, reconstructions that were done in a Making and Knowing project. And at the bottom, you see the beetle after casting. And of course, that needs a lot of tooling. For little lizards, there is a drawing in the manuscript, as you can see here on the left. And for the reconstructions, they rebuild that in the clay. There's the clay pancake or lasagna, as it was in the recipe. And you see the pins here to pin the animal. Of course, this also was a dead lizard found by one of the team members on their holiday. And that was used. And that way it would be then covered again with clay. The whole thing would go in the kiln. The wax would be melted out and the lizard would evaporate and then you could cast your silver. So these are two lizards from that magnificent table piece from Jamnitzer. And they were taken off the piece for cleaning when the piece was restored. And you can already see that they are very, very lifelike, also the way they were shaped. And you have to do that as the recipe said. And these are details of their skin. And it's amazing, the detail is amazing because these lizards are about 2 centimeters big. So the detail is absolutely stunning. And that is what you can only achieve with these live casts. The skill that that requires is enormous. And that is all described in these recipes. So a beautiful testimony. A lot of the knowledge of these artists was gained also in the 16th century and early 17th century by a sort of interdisciplinary combination of skills. We tend to think in single disciplines, so making of engravings, painting, sculpture, goldsmiths work, and so on. But we need to think, especially in that period, in a much sort of more interdisciplinary way and combine all these things. And that also includes the way nature plays a part, the way early modern science plays a part, very connected to artisanship. And there are these environments at that time, and I want to just give you a taste of that. For example, in Florence, where in the late 16th century, but running far into the 17th century and early 18th century, under one roof in the Uffizi, what is now the Uffizi Gallery, and many of you probably have visited that, on the ground floor, there were all kinds of workshops established in 1588 called the Galleria dei Lavori, the gallery of labor, of crafts, to be better translated. It must have been an absolutely buzzing place, you know, where all these different crafts were together. There's the Italian list here, but you can see painters, sculptors, porcelain makers, jewelers, all kinds of goldsmiths, but also alchemists and glass blowers and so on, and engineers even, and architects. They were all under one roof, and the materials that they used were bought in by one person for all the different workshops. So it was really organized as a sort of, we probably would call it now, the creative industries, you know, all under one roof, working together, one sort of conglomerate of knowledge, technical knowledge, artisanal knowledge. And no doubt there was a lot of exchange between them. This is one of the orders, for example, where materials were brought in, and you see all kinds of materials coming from Spain and from Flanders for different workshops, brushes to pigments to enamels, etc., including smalt from Flanders, which I will come back to in a minute. These are two paintings in the Studiolo from Francesco de' Medici in Florence, and it gives you a bit of an idea on how that must have looked. This is the goldsmith's workshop, the jewelry workshop on the left, and you can see it's a big workshop, lots of things happening, masters, apprentices, different techniques, different objects. And here you see kilns where things were, you know, melted, etc. And of course, the prince would visit to see. Many princes and dukes, etc., at that time in Italy would also sometimes participate. That was part of their interest and their education. On the right, you see a glassblower's workshop, the same Studiolo, also a big workshop. Also very informative for me as a technical art historian on techniques, on tools and activity and workshop choreography and all these things, fantastic kind of images. And imagine all these people under one roof and many, many more. And these are just two professions. And then you get these kind of objects, which is, this is a little tabernacle. It's in Vienna in the Kunsthistorische Museum, and it is from those workshops in Florence. And you can see here the top parts and the columns are rock crystal. That was a separate profession, cutting rock crystal. Then in the background, you see the pietre dure, so the semi-precious stone and inlay, beautiful sort of mosaic style inlay. That's a separate profession again. All the gold ornaments on it and also the figures here were definitely made by the goldsmiths and the silversmiths, and the enamelers would have done all the enameling. And there's fantastic, and I must correct myself. These are actually also made from semi-precious stone. And this is also a semi-precious stone, but the enameling is present here on the small ornamental decorations, as you can see here too. So you have all these different professions working together, creating these amazing objects, which were for the Medici court, almost a Medici brand. But there was also a lot of skill transfer and knowledge exchange, and they pushed each other to be more and more skilled and create new techniques, technical innovation. Well, a bit of history like that, and I mentioned already the smalt from Flanders, is also a nice example on how all these things connect. So I'm now jumping a bit in time, but it's clearly connected with this early period. And I show you this collector's cabinet from the Rijksmuseum. It's an absolutely wonderful cabinet where there's all kinds of species of plants and minerals, etc. It's an apothecary's cabinet, could you, if you like. And you see in the middle here, this little panel here, showing the pharmacist looking into a bottle. And all these little pots contain something. But they also, the cabinet itself contains many layers with minerals and plant materials and so on, beautifully laid out and labeled. And it's absolutely fascinating microcosmos of everything material that was around. And one of the layers contains so-called chemical glass, which turned out to be fragments. So this is the layer, the drawer, and this are these fragments, and they are part of so-called glass cakes. And here you see one from Miotto, a manufacturing company in the early 17th century until the 18th century in Murano. And they made these so-called glass cakes and stamped with their own brand by pouring hot glass, which was specially prepared with a lot of color in it, on a metal plate, let it cool down and stamp it. And then you, as an enameler or a glassmaker, could buy these and use them for enamels. This is just to show you how it's still done, but now they make them square, but they're still working in the same way. And these can be bought for enamels and for glassmaking, etc. It's absolutely beautiful color. So this enameling is like painting with glass. And there's, again, a beautiful text about that that explains how to do that. And here you see one of these Limoges enamels from the Rijksmuseum. It's absolutely stunning colors, but all the colors are made like these glass cakes that I showed you. So you would buy a piece and you would cut it and grind it, and then the ground glass will work like a pigment, and you put a binding medium to it and you could paint on the copper where of the enamel. It would go in the kiln, etc. And this is all described in this treatise by Blancourt, which talks about the methods of painting on glass and enameling, and also how to extract the colors from minerals, metals, herbs, and flowers. A work containing many secrets and curiosities never before discovered. Well, most of them claimed that, but of course they were trying to really make it very appealing to buy the book or to engage with them. But here you see a detail of that same enamel that I just showed you, and you can see how it is indeed brush strokes in different colors. It is painting with glass. Well, that blue contains cobalt, and cobalt containing glass is also a pigment that was used in painting called smalt. And you saw already in that list of materials for the workshops in Florence that they would buy smalt from Flanders. And indeed, Dutch smalt was very, or Netherlandish, I should say, at that time, was very popular and of a high quality. It's a very complex pigment to make. And one of the things we do in technical art history is that we try to reconstruct things so we can then understand how actually these things worked and if these recipes function or not. And this is a laboratorium reconstruction where all the materials that we find through analysis, scientific analysis, but also through studying all these recipes are laid out. And you see the kiln here and the little crucibles where you put a mixture of metals in and frit, that is glass. And then it is being made by this wonderful team in the University of Lisbon. You can see it's not an easy job. You have to quench it in water. And then you see immediately the blue color coming up. And now she's trying to separate the blue glass from the crucible, which is not an easy thing to do. But you see the immensely beautiful color. And this is it. This is what they made, smalt. And it replaces one of the most expensive pigments on the palette at the time, ultramarine, which was made of lapis lazuli blue. And lapis lazuli had to be imported all the way from what is now Afghanistan via the Middle East, Venice, where it often was already processed into a pigment, and then to Amsterdam, Antwerp, etc. Very, very expensive. And smalt, coming from the glass industry in the 16th century, the glass cakes, as I just showed you, that whole industry was really crucial for this. In the 17th century, it becomes a more separate industry where a glass smalt was made for painting. And it's absolutely stunning color, so you can imagine why it was used so much. However, there was a problem, there is a problem with smalt. And I'm showing you here a painting by Joachim Utterwal on the left, Annunciation to the Shepherds in the Rijksmuseum. It's a very big painting, and a lot of the colors, it seems a bit unbalanced in terms of color. And that is because Utterwal used the blue smalts in many areas in this painting. For example, this drapery here in the center, it's also part of the this more pink trousers of the shepherd, the clouds area here around there, there's all smalt in this area as well. And it all is no longer blue. And if you look on the right, this is a cross section, again, one of these tiny samples that shows you the layer built up of the painting. This is the ground layer. So it had a brownish ground with a gray on top that you see a lot as a preparation. And then this brown dark stuff is smalt, but it is no longer showing any blue. And on top is a little bit of reddish pink, which is taken the sample from this area here. In ultraviolet light, the same sample, we often use that so we can see a lot more of the structure because materials all fluoresce differently. You can see these particles better of the smalt. And this is a 500 times magnification. So here you see it even better of that area. All these sort of gray particles, very charry, like glass charts, that is all smalt. But it totally lost its color. And when you mix smalt with an oil, the fatty acids in the oil impact on the color. It's a very complex process, and there's still a lot of research going on to understand exactly what is happening. That really is problematic. However, I show you another painting, Maarten de Vos, Flemish painter. St. Michael, this painting is in Mexico, but painted in Antwerp and then transported to what was then called New Spain. There was a lot of trade going on, including paintings. And here you see a beautiful blue, and that blue is also smalt, and it is in perfect condition. It's still blue. So what is the difference? Why is this not, has this not changed? It is also in an oil binding medium. And if you look again at the cross section, these are the last cross sections I'm going to show you. You see the same, the top layer is beautifully blue. There's a bit of lead white mixed in this particular area because it was taken in a light area. But in a sample from the dark blue, it is just pure smalt and it's blue. But then the layer underneath it that you can see not very well here, murky, darkish, but here you can see it better in the ultraviolet light. There too, there is smalt, but that has lost its color. This is still quite a mystery. So when you try to understand these things, there's a lot of scientific analysis being done, and we can identify the composition of the smalt particles, etc. But there is something more going on here. And a very interesting piece of research was done by one of my students in technical art history, Paul van Laar, and he very kindly is sharing some information from a paper is forthcoming. And, you know, we are actually looking for the master secret. So grinding smalt is often mentioned in some recipes with an addition of egg white or rabbit skin glue or honey. And so that means that when you grind the pigment to make the particles the right size for the kind of paint you want, very fine or what kind of effect, depending on that, you can grind it with water, you can grind it with oil. There are different instructions for different pigments. For smalt, you often find certain instructions, but he found recipes where they actually talk about grinding it with smalt with good white honey, each for over an hour. It says, this is a recipe from a treatise from 1703 by an Alkmaar painter, a Dutch painter, Simon van Eikelenberg. And he calls these recipes ervarenissen, experiences. He talks about using this honey. So Paul van Laar did that. He reconstructed that all, ground the smalt with honey, extensively washed it. So Eikelenberg said you have to wash it many, many times until the water no longer tastes sweet, meaning the honey should be gone. So Paul did that and followed all that. And then with the transmission electron microscope, which can create a very high magnification, they looked at those particles and they still found this grayish material here around the particles. They still found honey there, creating a film. And that film seemed to protect maybe those particles from the impact of these fatty acids from the oil. That is an hypothesis, but that is a master secret we're trying to figure out, and we will work on that much further because there is plenty of smalt in the Night Watch and in many other paintings. So it's a fascinating problem where we combine the text with from the recipes with reconstructions and scientific analysis to uncover that secret. So this skill building that I showed you some examples of, maybe some slightly extreme examples, but really hopefully giving you an understanding of how complex these things are. So the skill building, the path to mastery, is a concept of hybrid forms of knowledge and working practices. Artisans exchange practices with other disciplines and collaborate. It's also talking about innovation driven by competition and changing demands. It's about reinvention of artisanal knowledge, finding new ways to use traditional methods and inventing totally different ways of working with materials or introducing new ones, and surviving trajectories of successful practices, which then disseminate through master to apprentice, etc. And I want to finish again with Minerva as the patroness of the arts. Here you see her again on the front page of Crispijn van der Passe's Of the Light of the Art of Drawing and Painting, published in Amsterdam, 1643. You see at her feet the apprentices drawing. And behind her, you see a whole range of very well-known painters from Utrecht, including Joachim Utterwaal, of whom we just saw the painting with all the discolored smalt. He is a part of that. A little bit attention for a well-known classic sculpture in the background. And on her lap, she has a book, of course, as one of her symbols, which says, Nulla dies sine linea, never a day without a line. And this is all about drawing and painting. And I think that is a very good closure of this lecture. And finishing with thanking the sponsors of the Night Watch and thanking you for your intention, and especially the Royal Philosophical Society of Glasgow and Pat Monaghan for inviting me for presenting this lecture on, I hope, skills and the wonder and marvel we as researchers feel when we work on this. Thank you very much.
Question number one is from Ronald Singleton, and he says, if an artwork is made up of perishable materials that begin to perish, should it be reconstructed by others?
Well, that's a very good question, of course. And a lot of materials in artworks degrade and age in different ways. So many, for example, in those paintings, many pigments are in perfect conditions. Many colors are fine, but like the smalt, that is discoloring, that is a serious, you know, change. Because you saw in that painting that the whole balance between colors is then changed. But we don't do anything about that because we can't change that back. And it would be not ethical to paint it over, if you like. A conservator would never do that. So we need to accept that these things happen. We now often talk about the biography of objects, the life of an object, starting at when it was conceived by the artist, the idea, and translated into materials, up till now, maybe 400 years later when we see it, and everything that happens in between, and that means impact from outside, conservation treatments, changes made in formats and so on, but also inherent to the materials, all kinds of aging processes. And unfortunately, those aging processes, we can't really do anything about. So we will make sure that the painting is stable, or the materials are stable, paint doesn't, you know, get damaged further, but we can't stop that process. Except, you know, we do things like UV filters for windows, etc., to slow it down, the impact of UV, for example, and so on, light and so on. But yes, unfortunately, we can't do that, and we would not do that because it's not something that in conservation is acceptable.
Thank you. The next question by somebody who often asks very good questions, who names himself or herself anonymous attendee, the question is, do modern pigments, it's related to the previous one, way, how do modern pigments last longer than traditional pigments?
Well, some of them definitely do, of course, because they are developed, a lot of modern pigments were developed in the 19th century, where the Industrial Revolution and chemistry is developed, and let's say synthetic alternatives for traditional pigments are coming on the market. But many in the beginning especially had problems. For example, if you look at Van Gogh paintings, he used a lot of synthetic organic dyes, as we call them, of red, geranium red, and nice names like that, which faded quite rapidly. And the Van Gogh Museum made a beautiful reconstruction of the bedroom, the famous bedroom of Van Gogh, where that color red has gone. And when they virtually added to it, it totally changed the whole painting, because then it, you know, you could see the different tones. So a lot of these pigments also have had problems, but there's still newer ones coming on the market. And of course, painters stopped using them because they quickly became aware of the unstable character of these pigments. So there are many traditional pigments, like earth pigments, for example, that are super stable. They don't change at all. So it's a mixture of, you know, quite a lot of the traditional pigments are very stable, and a lot of modern variations are very stable, but there have been problems as well, yes, with modern inventions, if you like.
Thank you. So if I may ask a question related to that, if a painting needs restoration, somebody has damaged it, or it's been left in ultraviolet exposed to ultraviolet light. Do conservators try and use the original or a modern equivalent?
For example, for retouching losses, I no longer work as a conservator, of course, but conservators would use, first of all, a layer in between the original paint and what you're going to add, like they call it a retouching varnish, very thin layer, so that there's always a distinction. And then you would use, modern pigments. You could use modern pigments because many of them are stable, but also like earth pigments that are traditional ones. And they never have been replaced because they are, you know, in abundance available and very good quality. So it's usually a mixture.
Thank you. For anyone who's interested in the Kelvin Grove Arts Gallery there, I haven't been there in recent weeks, obviously, but there's a wonderful painting by an artist, Gray, a lady artist, which is partially restored and you can see some of the dirt cleaned up. It's really very interesting. Anyway, next question is by Dallas Carter. Did any of the apprentices decide to specialize in making of paints and in other artistic materials instead of being painters? Making up the materials seemed to be a very specialized skill in itself, and I presume must have been very time consuming.
Yes, so in the 16th and 17th century, especially in the 16th century, there were lots of recipes in those treatises where they explain how to make certain pigments. And that can be incredibly complicated and also very toxic in some cases, so not easy. So quickly there were people specializing in doing that, and many of the pigments were then sold through, for example, apothecaries. So that's where you would go as a painter to buy your materials. So there were specialists making them, and you find all kinds of special places, like in Amsterdam. Outside of Amsterdam, you had the so-called paint mills, where they were grinding in the mill, just driven by power from the mill. They had a special room to grind pigments that were actually quite toxic so that the dust could not come out of the room. So they were aware of these things, and that was outside of the city. You wouldn't build something in that like that inside. So there were all kinds of specialists. And of course, in the 19th century, you get all these new pigments, etc. And then you get paints that are actually prepared, including the oil and everything, in tubes. But that's only from 1840 onwards. Then that's the day the paint tube was invented. Up till then, they all would still make their own paints, but they would buy the raw materials, the pigments, ready made. Yeah.
I was very impressed by how developed the industry, in a sense, the art industry was in those times. All those years ago, there must have been, you know, a whole system and a market for these very expensive things. So to have this must have been culturally, was there, you know, I believe that there was a time in Holland, in the Netherlands, when people had money because it was a very successful trading nation. But because of the nature of the society, very conservative society, people had artworks inside instead of showy wealth outside. Did that sort of thing influence the market at all, of the things that you were talking about in the era you were talking about?
Well, I think in the Netherlands, in the Northern Netherlands, there was very much a mercantile society, and everybody had paintings. And the market, so painters worked for all kinds of echelons of the society, if you like, very expensive pieces to more of mainstream, depending for, you know, where they, it was very market driven. And those things have an enormous impact on techniques and materials, because when landscapes became very popular, there was a new style of painting landscapes, which was really fast and very quick in but very effective and very beautiful. And it made it possible to produce a huge number of paintings and to serve that market demand, right? So it's very important. It's a very good point that you make, because you always have to put these things in perspective. You cannot just study a new technique that suddenly arrives without looking into the environment around it. Why is this technique there? And you always find your answers in the environment, the society, the trade, what was available, what was the market demand. All these things come together, and that's really important.
Thank you. Keith MacDonald asked, he assumes that the art, science, and technology work together and improves our culture. How could we encourage that today? an easy question.
That's not such an easy question. I mean,
no, I know.
That's all about interdisciplinarity and cross-discipline and multidiscipline. I mean, it's what we all in academia too talk about a lot. I think from my experience, working with others is hugely, for me, it's very important, and it really broadens my horizon enormously. And I learn a lot from scientists and the way they think and the way they look at things. And they say the same to me when we're talking about art research, of course, technical research. And it's fascinating to do that. But I think you still need to be able to really be thorough in your own fields and in your own discipline. It's a bit like somebody called it a T-shape researcher. So the vertical of the T is your disciplinary, you know, you run discipline, you go into depth, but the horizontal bar of the T is this broad reaching out to other disciplines. And I think that is a very nice symbol of how it enriches your understanding of what's going on. And I do think without that, you do miss a more thorough and more broad and more, you know, based on the world very in interpretation.
Wendy Service, or her husband, asks, is there any crossover between rediscovery of techniques of glass-based paint and the study of stained glass, in particular the method of production of some early blue stained glass?
Absolutely, yes, yes, yes. There are more crossovers than I showed in that in the talk, because I already went over time, I think. So but there are definitely, yes, stained glass, the coloring of stained glass, it all hangs together, it all connects together. Absolutely. I mean, another thing that I didn't mention is that in the recipe books you find a lot of recipes to make fake gems, including sapphires, the blue sapphires. And that is, again, glass. And that is, again, blue glass, cobalt glass, etc. So all these things, these smalts that are mentioned in price lists, etc., are also used for stained glass as well. That's a good point. Yeah.
Thank you. Questions are jumping around a bit here. Do conservationists work on restoring their own areas of specialty? In other words, does somebody work on insect wings and another on plants? Or does the subject matter matter less than the original painter? So does somebody stick with the painter or go with elements of their painting? This is from our anonymous attendee friend.
Well, it's a very good question. In the Rijksmuseum, for example, we have under one roof, we have quite a lot of different studios. So glass, paper, ceramics, paintings, furniture, etc. And there's lots of collaboration. So if an object has sort of, let's say, mixed media, so different materials, then we do, you see colleagues that they go and ask another expert, because every one of those colleagues is an expert in their own fields. So, but with the wings of the butterflies, that's of course a different story, because I don't think anybody is an expert in conservation in that, except maybe people who work on natural history objects like butterflies and, you know, other natural history objects. So it would make full sense to talk to them. And I started that conversation about how in that period of time would they preserve butterfly wings? And is there a method there that this particular painter, Otto Marsuys von Schrick, could have used, or, you know, to transfer these scales of these wings to the painting, sticking them in the varnish and then removing the membrane, leaving the scales behind? It seems so incredibly difficult. There must have been a method that was easier for him. And maybe that comes from, so maybe he already, I'm sure, actually, he talked to specialists at the time, experts at the time, and inserted that then in his paintings. And we should do that too. We should definitely do that too. Yeah.
The next question, and we're actually running a little out of time, but I think we'll get them, some of them in. Would pigments and colors used by Dutch artists have been used throughout Europe, or was there regional variation? From anonymous attendee.
Can you repeat that?
Were the pigments used by Dutch artists the same throughout Europe, or were
there
variation?
Well, you do find some small local things. For example, if organic pigments that are made from plants, for example, especially in watercolor or manuscript illumination, you do find sometimes that artists working in a particular area would use local plants, which would grow, let's say, in southern Europe, but not in the north, for example. But most of the inorganic pigments, so like earths and so on, were available throughout Europe, and they can be manufactured locally, and there might be a specialist like Smalt from Flanders, as you saw in that list from Florence. So clearly there must have been a specialist there, a manufacturer, an industry that produced very high quality, and then it would be imported to Florence in the late 16th century to be used there, you know. But in principle, they had very similar use of pigments, and these pigments, let's say, traveled. So there was trade all over Europe. Yeah.
I think there's one last question, and I apologize for not being able to cover all the others, but this one I think you've actually touched on before, so it may not be too long to answer. Robert Thompson asks if the paintings where blue has faded so badly, is there a point where it really can't be restored, or where it's too dangerous to the painting's integrity to try and restore it?
Yes, if a pigment fades or discolors, or but as long as the paint layer is stable, so not, let's say, cracking and flaking, but it's stable, we would not touch it. That's the short answer. we would accept that the color is gone. As you saw in that painting that I showed you from Utewaal, a lot of the smalt has discolored, and that's how it is on display.
Well, I think we'll have to end the questions there, but thank you very much, Irma, for a most interesting lecture. I didn't really know what to expect, and I suspect I may not have been the only one to know the journey of a painting or an artwork from inspiration, where they got their utensils and their elements, their pigments, how they actually crafted things, how you can analyze that today, what to make of it, philosophy of restoring, the limits, and I bet there's a lot more of the science that you could have blinded us with tonight, various forms of analysis, but for another day, perhaps. So
I'm sure you will realize I could have spoken for many more hours.
I know, and I think we would have enjoyed that. Anyhow, but thank you so very much. And I'm just going to try and see if I can screen share now. Huh. Right. So this is, as Emma mentioned earlier, the Minerva lecture. And when the Philosophical Society was initially started about 300 years ago, it was started as a way of promoting science and arts. And there was an arts medal at one stage, but it wasn't a named medal. And they wanted to give it equal prestige to the Kelvin medal and so on. So Minerva was chosen because there's a link with Minerva. Minerva is the original membership certificates of the society were stamped with this stamp on the left. This is the name of the book it came from. It's misfiled in foreign history. And it's also on the rear of the backrest of the master's chair, which is safely, I believe, in Strathclyde University. And Minerva, being the Roman goddess, as Emma mentioned, of wisdom, and we'll skip over one or two aspects of her skills and remit, which is very wide, but sponsor of the arts, crafts, and more. So I think we've been treated tonight to a most wonderful lecture covering elements of the art that we may not have known anything about or not have realized, painted glass paint and so on. And a hint of the vast scientific contribution to this. So thank you very much, Irma. And this is a picture of the medal that will be posted to you. And it's to recognize your contribution to the society in your skill and your knowledge of the arts. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. You're very welcome. And thank you very much for the invitation.